Theodor Herzl, father of the Jewish state, the leader fired by an ancient vision whose strength of faith, personal charm, and immense activity renewed that vision, making it alive and dynamic. Mover of men, the inspiration of his people, who organized them into a political force and a factor in international affairs. And the vision becomes reality. The home is reached, and the state of Israel is once more established. We meet the maturing young Herzl in Vienna, where he lived from 1878, and from whence he went forth to fight the nine-year battle for his vision, a battle which changed the face of history for the Jewish people. He is a well-known author in Vienna, whose plays meet with great success at the Berg Theater. Herzl is also a staff reporter for the Vienna newspaper, Neue Freie Presse. In 1892, he leaves to be the paper's permanent representative in Paris. And in Paris, at the French Parliament, and in the offices of the Foreign Ministry, Herzl is given the opportunity to study the paths and the significance of political endeavor. Herzl succeeds in this new sphere and quickly becomes one of the most renowned men in Paris. Then comes the crisis which alters his entire life. The trial of Alfred Dreyfus, the Jewish captain falsely accused of espionage, whose sentence was exile on Devil's Island. Herzl is present at the trial and hears Dreyfus say, "I am not guilty." Then, in the De Castel Hotel, Herzl sits down at a small desk and writes his book, The Jewish State. "I seem to hear the beating of wings above my head," writes Herzl. "I wrote, walking, standing, lying down, at the desk at night, and whenever I awoke with a start from my sleep. I felt as if my own life was suspended and the history of the world was beginning." In this mood of exaltation, Herzl wrote his book, The Jewish State. From Paris, Herzl returns to his house and study in Vienna. Here he worked to attract supporters for his vision and to impart this vision to the Jewish leaders and the Jewish people at large. The desk at which he worked, standing before a picture of his father, a cultured and kind man, the first to believe in his son's historic mission. And next to it, a picture of his mother, who accompanied him on his chosen journey. And from this room, Herzl goes forth to Turkey, England, and Paris, to meetings with statesmen, rulers of nations, and his fellow Jews. In 1896, he begins to form the World Zionist Organization. Herzl goes to Baal in 1897 to organize the first Zionist Congress. Invitation to the Congress, he writes, "The meeting in Baal will mark the beginning of a new period in the development of our movement." On August the 29th, the first of the Hebrew month of Elul, the Congress opens, attended by 203 delegates from East and West. The Baal plan is adopted. It opens with the words, "The Zionist movement aims to create for the Jewish people a home in Palestine secured by public law." And while in Baal, in the Three Kings Hotel overlooking the Rhine, he writes, "Here in Baal, I founded the Jewish state. Perhaps in 5 years, but definitely in 50 years, the world will accept this fact." A year later, Herzl convenes the second Zionist Congress in Baal. At that time, the Zionist vision was gaining momentum, and the Zionist organization was paving the way to a realization of its goal. At the Second Congress, Herzl establishes the Jewish Colonial Trust, which was to be the financial instrument of the Zionist organization. After the first congresses, Herzl goes to Istanbul and meets the German Kaiser. From there, to Palestine, accompanied by Zionist leaders and friends. The ship anchors in Jaffa Port. From there, he goes on to Mikveh Yisrael, the first Jewish agricultural school in Palestine. Here, Herzl meets the German Kaiser once again in order to enlist his support at the court of the Turkish Sultan who ruled Palestine at the time. From Mikveh Yisrael, Herzl travels to Jerusalem on the antiquated Turkish railway, riding past the bare landscape of the Judean hills. On arrival, he lodges in this house, facing the walls of the ancient Jerusalem. And here, against the background of the walled city, he and his delegation of Jewish leaders meet the German Kaiser for the third time. He reads the Kaiser the memorandum which had been requested of him. "This is the land of our fathers. Look upon this land, Your Highness. It cries out for cultivation and settlement." On his return from Palestine, Herzl writes his book, Alt Neuland, Old New Land. In the preface was written, "If you will it, it is no dream." And in the book itself, a description of life in the future Jewish state. Once more he journeys to the Third Zionist Congress, to the peace conference for a meeting with the Turkish Sultan, and to London, where he again meets the royal officials and Jewish leaders and tries to mobilize funds for the purchase of land in Palestine. The Fourth Zionist Congress takes place in London. 2 years go by. The Fifth Congress resolves to found the Jewish National Fund. Herzl travels to Russia to meet the Tsar and his ministers. In Vilna, he is royally received, and the Jewish community presents him with a Torah scroll as a memento. But strain begins to show. Herzl feels that death is near. He parts from his mother and enters a sanatorium in the Austrian mountains. After a month's illness, on the 20th of Tammuz, July the 3rd, 1904, Herzl dies. He is 44 years old, in the prime of life. A large throng, representative of the whole Jewish people, follows his coffin through Vienna. The Jewish nation mourns. A sense of irretrievable loss pervades its people. His fellow Jews in Palestine have immortalized his name. In forests, streets, towns, settlements, everywhere. Becomes a living reality, and on the 5th of Iyar, May the 14th, 1948, 44 years after Herzl's death, David Ben-Gurion proclaims the founding of the State of Israel in Palestine. With the proclamation of the state, the gates are thrown open, and among the ships carrying tens of thousands of immigrants from Europe and the East sails the Theodor Herzl. Second year of Israel's independence, the 22nd of Av, August 1949, the nation fulfills Herzl's last request, that he be buried in Israel. His remains are brought to Jerusalem for burial on Mount Herzl, high among the hills surrounding the city. "I do not know the hour of my death," he wrote in 1898, "but Zionism will not die. Since the days of Baal, the Jewish people once again have a national representative body, and the Jewish state will be established in the homeland. At the site of his grave, a temporary monument surrounded by flowers was erected. Close by lie the fighters who sacrificed their lives in the War of Independence, the resting place of those who fought for the realization of Herzl's vision. Mount Herzl overlooks the capital of Israel, Jerusalem, which Herzl envisaged as a new and expansive city. And from Jerusalem to Haifa, city of the future, about which Herzl prophesied in his book, Alt Neuland, that it would be a blossoming modern city, a port and a center of industry. He prophesied, and his vision became reality. The nation is once again on its own land, protecting it, and making the wilderness fertile. Agricultural settlements have arisen from end to end of the country, and the towns and villages are enfolded by greenery. Thus spoke Herzl. Therefore must you have faith, for a new and wondrous generation of Jews will arise in Israel. The sons of the Maccabees will be born to a new life.